The following is a presentation of the Black Hollywood Live Network, the first online broadcast network dedicated to African-American entertainment. Hollywood redefined. From Los Angeles, California, streaming live thanks to Akamai Technologies, this is Black Hollywood Live, the Black Tea Party, featuring weekly discussions on political news and current affairs. Black Hollywood Live, Hollywood redefined.
You're listening to Black Hollywood Live.
And now, the host of Black Hollywood Live, the Black Tea Party.
Hey, everybody. Good afternoon. Good afternoon. This is Shirley Husar, H-U-S-A-R. Oh, they're starting with Lauryn Hill. Hey, come on, Don. Start singing.
I'll let Lauryn do that.
We love Lauryn. You know, Lauryn was just here in Los Angeles. Hi, my name is Shirley Husar, H-U-S-A-R. I am here with my co-host, my amazing co-host, Don. You can follow me on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, LinkedIn. Follow us, Urban Game Changers. We're making changes in the urban community. Don.
Ah, I'm so happy to be here, Black Tea Party. Mm-hmm. We got a whole lot going on in this world this week, so we want to talk about it all, right?
Oh, my God.
Don't forget to follow me, Don's Daily Dose and Don Nash on Facebook and on Twitter. Let's talk about it. Have some tea.
Have some tea.
Yeah.
Some black tea.
Yeah.
Well, recently, tomorrow is our big day for African-American people. That's right. The 1010 Justice or Else is going to be in Washington, D.C. Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan will be there. There will be millions of marchers. Men across the country are traveling right now. Many men in Los Angeles have left. Our wonderful, who has left? That's his name.
Anthony Martin, our own Anthony Martin is out there.
Anthony Martin is on the ground. I think he's going to be videotaping and taking pictures. And so next
week, talking to some folk about their experience.
We'll be hearing more about that.
Absolutely.
I'm excited about that. But guess what? We do have a very special guest today. A wonderful minister, Minister Victor Muhammad. Victor Muhammad is Skyping in right now from Justice or Else. He is part of the MAS 22, if that is correct. He is the Minister of Ministers for the Muhammad, for the Nation of Islam. He's excited, and he's here to tell us a little bit about it. I know there's a lot of controversy. You guys have seen me do videos. As a matter of fact, I recently had a kind of a debate, not of a debate, but a difference with the minister. And since we are trying to come to a better understanding, he was kind enough to come on our show, the Black Tea Party, which I'm very honored to have him. Victor, are you out there?
I am here.
Yay, Victor.
There he is.
Oh, there he is. Ah, there he is. There he is. How are you doing, Victor?
I'm great. How are you?
I'm doing good. Can you show everyone your shirt? You showed me your shirt earlier.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely.
Wow.
Victor, I got to get one of those.
Yeah, Victor, can you bring us back two shirts? Can you get us a shirt?
We're going to see that you get two shirts.
Yay! Yeah.
Yeah, because we're standing with you from L.A.
Yeah. And we big people over here.
Right. Two X.
Two X. I got some big. Okay, hold the girls up. The girls need to be filled in. So, yeah, it's okay if it's a little larger. It's all good.
Okay.
Victor, can you share a little bit? Can you make it clear? Let's explain what Justice is. What Justice or Else is. I'm sure that you can do that better than anyone.
Well, I can't do it better than the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan, but, you know, we're just at a critical point in this nation where people just want to be treated fairly. And unless they start treating people fairly, we're bringing an imbalance to the American people. Justice is represented by two scales, which shows balance. And when people are not treated just, we are seeing an imbalance in the American society. So that means fair dealing, that means treating people right, and giving the people the true freedom, justice, and equality that they're looking for.
Mm. Wow, that's amazing. So this is 20 years, right? It's been 20 years since...
Since the first march.
Yes. What do you think is going to be different, Don?
I don't know. I'm actually, I have a lot of anticipation about this. And so I'm really excited to talk to Victor tonight to find out organizationally what's projected to come forward. I know that when I look back 20 years ago, it was about obviously justice at that time, but it was also about kind of like black men atoning for the failure in terms of our absenteeism in the family and in the social structure. And so I'm interested to see how that's going to graduate to a different level this year, you know, at this anniversary. So Victor, could you shed some light on that? Or I mean, are we still dealing with that personal responsibility?
Yeah, and that is always a given. You know, under the Honorable Elijah Muhammad and the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan, all of our reforms are based off of self-help and taking responsibility for our actions. It is a given the condition that we have come to this country in and the gross inequalities that still persist in this country. But unless we take hold of our own lives and take responsibility for what we do, we will never find a way out. And as a lot of people say in recovery, the first step to recovery is just admitting that we have a problem.
Yeah.
And so the one thing that we want to do in recovering our dignity and our pride is to be able not only to take responsibility for ourselves as a people, but look at the overall humanity that is suffering from gross injustice. We see women who are not being paid fair wages as men are being paid. And we don't think that a woman should be paid less because of her biology when she has the skill to do what a man can do. Also, we are looking at this country falling apart at the seams dealing with the immigration crisis, when they always have a way of justifying why one set of people can come and another set of people cannot come. We don't find that to be fair whatsoever. So we want to address that which the indigenous people who were put out of this country and then labeled illegal immigrants. And then we have the American Indian who still hasn't been treated fairly despite all the treaties that America has promised them. And we have some of the worst health crisis ever given to a people based off of the way they've been treated by the American government. And then we also have where we have to have better schools across the board. There's just so much that justice touches that we don't want to diminish how important justice really is when you're dealing with fair dealing and making sure that there's truly justice for all.
Justice for all, absolutely. Let me ask you this, you're a minister, is that correct?
I'm a student minister. I'm still studying, I'm still trying to get better.
So explain, you know, that, you said you're a student minister of the 22nd Mosque, did I say that correctly?
Mosque 22 in Pittsburgh.
Yes, I don't know what that means, so help me out there.
Well, when you study the Nation of Islam's history, you will find that the order in which the mosque were established are in a sequential order.
Okay.
And the very first mosque started by Master Farid Muhammad, the teacher of the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad, was started in Detroit, Michigan, and that's Temple Number One. Of course, the second mosque was in Chicago, which is our headquarters, that is now known as Mosque Mariam, named after the mother of Jesus. But that was mosque number two. And then we went to Milwaukee for three, Washington, D.C. for four, and so on. So Muhammad's Mosque 22, that was the 22nd mosque established under the leadership of the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad.
Now, what do you guys do in this mosque? What do you do?
Well, we teach people the reality of the scriptures. We look at the fulfillment of prophecy and the time that we're living in, and to show that we believe that we are those that are described in the Bible, that are the lowly, rejected, and the despised, and that would be in a country that is not their own for 400 years, after which time God himself would come and raise us and take us unto himself to make us an example for the rest of the world.
I want to thank you, number one, for just breaking us off this kind of knowledge, because I think our viewers oftentimes get caught in the rhetoric of the media that would sometimes not give us an accurate picture of what the Nation of Islam really stands for. And what you've talked about in terms of this Million Man March has provoked a lot of questions for me. You're speaking about equality, but I know that oftentimes the nation shows up to not necessarily deal with the rights or equal rights of women or even people that are not necessarily black. But it sounds like this is an overarching thing where you all are taking a prophetic voice in this social climate as a nation to bring about equality. Can you speak to that? I mean, have we been misreading it? Have you all been mislabeled in the mass media? Does that make sense? My line of questions?
Good question, yes.
Okay.
That's a good question. We've absolutely been mislabeled. And, you know, and one example is, the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan is the only Muslim leader in the world that has ever appointed a woman over a mosque.
Okay.
In the history of Islam, okay, from the time of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, to present time, he's the only one. Because the Honorable Elijah Muhammad has always stated the fact that the most important thing to nation building is the woman, because she is the first teacher. And we're taught that the woman's home is not her place, it is her base. And if her base is messed up, then we see what the condition of the rest of the world would be, because the hand that rocks the cradle truly rules the world.
Okay, and then I think, and allow me to just kind of provoke some questions here, because I wanna give answers to our viewing audience. I know that, and I won't expect for you to justify anything that the Honorable Louis Farrakhan maybe have said in times past, but there's been clips and speeches where he's maybe looked at the white man as the devil, but now we're talking about people that, a hue of color that doesn't necessarily look like black men, right? I mean, Hispanics are in this line, right? Am I right or wrong about that?
Hispanics are in what line? I don't understand that.
Well, what I've read in some of the things that have been published is that this particular march is going to be open to more than just black men.
Right.
But Hispanic men.
Right.
As well. So has that changed fundamentally over the last 20 years? Has there been a paradigm shift?
Well, if you look at any prophetic movement, and we can go all the way back to Moses, we can move up to Jesus, or we can move to Prophet Muhammad. When we see these great men of wisdom, when God first chooses these men, he chooses that people that the man comes from. He chooses that people based off of a wretched condition that only he can lift them from. And if only he can lift them from, then no one else in the world can take credit for them. So as the Nation of Islam was evolving, and we believe that God himself had come and raised the Honorable Elijah Muhammad and left for us as a reminder the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan. Mm-hmm. The message was first dealing with the lowly, rejected, and the despised of this country, and we could find no other people fitting that description better than black people. However, God is not a narrow God. He may start with the chosen people, but he chooses that people for all people.
I love that. I love that.
You know, Minister, you have to agree with me that we live in very strange times where the climate of black brutality, police brutality, there's a lot of things going on in this country where a lot of black men are dying, more so than 20 years ago. I think so. Let me ask you this. The minister is looked up as a threat to black people and some of the white communities that are out there. We all have friends who aren't so much supporters of the minister, and the things that he has said is kind of frightening. He has basically said that white people are evil. He said white people deserve to die. He said justice or else, regarding that death is sweeter. It sounds like he is telling young black men that whatever happens, if they don't comply to the law that you guys are going to implement, that they will have to take action in another way by any means necessary. Is that the message that should be said to these young people out on the streets today?
Well, that needs to be understood. Black people, from the time that they were brought here, you know, unlike the McGraw-Hill book saying that we were immigrants that came here for work, we were brought here. And on being brought here, we were always subjected to being killed. So we have to get that right out. And for what the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan gave us from his teacher, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, about the evils and the atrocities done to us by Caucasian people that are not just done to us here in America today, but are being done all over the world to this day, we can find no better description of that type of atrocity than evil. However, he's not telling people to give, to just recklessly give their lives or to become martyrs. But the
he said death is sweeter. He said it's better to die. He said in videos it's better to die.
Those were American mantras as well, because they said, give me liberty or give me death. Nathan Hale talked about how death would be better. The New Hampshire state motto is live free or die. He's saying that if we cannot get the rights of a human being and we have to always be subjected to this killing, well, sooner or later, that's going to have a consequence. And having a consequence, you know, people take the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan as a threat because you can't scare him.
No, they take him as a threat because of the words that he said. Come on, he says things that are very violent, well, which are very intimidating, which are very frightening. He has frightening statements and frightening words all on the internet. These videos are flying everywhere. You guys even edit your own stuff to come off kind of more intimidating. You're intimidating. You're frightening. We as black people, we don't have the same guns as the federal government. We don't have the same equipped weapons as the federal government. And if we were to go to war, we would be the ones attacked and tread upon. Is that right? Does it make it right that we step back and say, look at history. If they did it, we can do it. History's never applied to us. History's never supported us the way it has supported itself. So why tell these young people to go out and do these things?
We're not saying that history applied to us or anything, but we're saying that prophecy is on our side and the moral right of the universe. As Dr. King told us, that if you don't have anything to die for, you don't have anything worth living for.
Now, I hear that, Victor, but help me reconcile this, because I'm trying to connect these dots. That prophecy is on your side, and you spoke prophetically about God choosing a people that had been disenfranchised or held down, but choosing those people in prophetic intentionality to expand for all people. But then we come here with this, and it seems like that's a breakaway from that prophetic utterance, if that makes sense. Do you see? It sounds like it's a tension there. Right. What do you think?
No, it's right in line with that. Because when in the Holy Quran and the Bible, the people always wanted to test God and tell them, bring us that which you threaten us with. Mm. See, the threat doesn't come from the men. The threat comes from the God. And the God, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad said that God was not going to allow any outside force to destroy America. He saved America for himself. And he was going to use rain, hail, snow, and earthquakes to destroy America. And we're watching that very thing happening. But because we don't have a grasp of scripture, we only look at scripture as something that happened in the past, not something that's being fulfilled as we live.
Well, let's go back 20 years. We had this event, the Million Man March. Many men were there. They were motivated. They felt good. There was a brotherhood that took place. Unfortunately, 20 years have passed, and look where we're at. Look where our people have come to. Look how so many of them have been slaughtered since then. You know, do you have an agenda that implements some type of legislation? Because emotion and feel good and love and help and let's all come together is one thing. But to have some type of law, some type of proposal to position a new candidate, is he trying to talk to the top runners for the Democrat or Republican Party? I mean, what are you guys doing as far as legislation regarding since then to now? Because I haven't seen anything in 20 years come out of it.
Well, as far as legislation, we have to remember 20 years ago, those that black people would want to call, or that one that the black people would want to call the first black president because he played the saxophone on the Arsenio Hall show. You do remember that.
We know Bill Clinton. He's not black, but go ahead.
No, he's not. But they considered him that because he could entertain black folks. And he was the one that set up the mandatory minimum that sent a lot of our black fathers away. As the scripture says, smite the shepherd, scatter the flock. So some of these fathers, through these mandatory minimums, were tearing the family apart. Because we have to remember, not only does the father go to jail, his mother does the time with him, his woman tries to hang on as long as she can, and if the children get to know him, by the time he's out, they're so disconnected from him, and they're testing these young black men for medical problems going in, but they're not testing them coming out of these institutions. So they're coming among black women spreading AIDS and hepatitis and diseases throughout our community. So we have a war on all these fronts.
And all due respect, Minister, I'm in support, and I identify what you're saying is valid and which is true. But you didn't answer my question. I asked you, 20 years has passed. What type of legislation has the Nation of Islam proposed? You have attorneys. You have people who are politically involved in the black communities. These black communities are ran by black leaders, and these black people are still being slaughtered. We also have in Los Angeles, where three strikes, you're out. No one's trying to amend those laws. If there's laws that are in place that are allocated by a president or anyone, if those laws have to be amended, what purpose did you do to alter that? Because we all know that story. That story is nothing new for our people. What is not new is I don't see anything that came out of 20 years.
Well, I don't see any legislation that's come in the past 400 years that they've...
But that legislation should have came from your people. If you guys are going to have this march that you did 20 years ago, you should leave there with an agenda. That agenda should say, we're going to do this. You should talk to your local legislators. You should have put that legislation into place. And we've had 20 years that we all could have had some type of validation to say, hey, this, we've got legislation, put it in place for protection or a betterment for black people.
We don't put our faith in legislation. We put our faith in God. However, the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan is going to be very clear tomorrow afternoon. He's going to be very clear on what our agenda is, what our position is, and what the programmatic means are that we're going to move forward from this point on.
Is there something that's a part of the agenda, and as much that you can share, that would bring about, let's just say, connectivity on an ongoing basis that would help develop men as leaders of the home, the family, the community, where we could see progress on that level? I get there's not legislation. He's indicated they put their faith in God and not in legislation.
I understand.
But I'm looking at the personal responsibility and just being on the outside of observing the Nation of Islam. Y'all some of the most disciplined folk I've ever met in my
God.
Life.
They look good.
You
they
know,
got their nice suits and bow ties.
And yet I think when we look at the demise of just the black man in the fabric of America over the last 20 years, I can't help but think we need some of that. I've read and I've listened to some of the testimonies of men that were there 20 years ago and how their lives were turned around. You know, one brother left, I think his last name was McGee, I forget his first name, left the Million Man March 20 years ago and went and filled out an application at Harvard.
Awesome.
Right, and is now coming back, will be there tomorrow, traveling with his, I think, with three generations in his family.
Wow.
And then we'll go on to meet at the White House to talk about some financial planning for charter schools and things of that nature. So they're great testimonies. But that's what I'm speaking to, that personal responsibility.
Right.
Because in everything that we've seen happen here socially,
absolutely,
the injustice among black men, I'm always troubled because I think that we don't recognize our personal responsibility in it.
Absolutely.
You know, I couldn't agree with you more, but I think the one thing that the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan does not get enough credit for in our community is he always wants to be the great uniter of our people. He's really put us on a great study of Dr. Martin Luther King and some of the other leaders of the past and trying to reconcile history where we no longer have to see the division. We no longer have to see Booker T versus W.E.B. Du Bois, or we don't have to see Malcolm versus Martin. We're coming to the point now where we're seeing that, look, all and our struggle had something good to offer. And I say that to say, I've been studying the March on Washington, and I thought it was very interesting when Dr. King was introduced, he was introduced as the moral leader. And the one thing, after all that they talk about, I have a dream and I've been to the mountaintop, the one thing that they don't talk about is the morality factor of our people. Our morals have to be redirected, you know, because a lot of times we like to say, well, there are no more leaders, but where are the leaders in morality among our people?
Absolutely. Right. We have only 1 minute left, and I'm going to let Don go ahead, and I'll close it out.
No, I thank you. I mean, I thank you for the clarity that you brought here today. I thank you for the prophetic Absolutely. Vision that you have made so clear as it relates to the Nation of Islam and the intention. And if there is one thing that those of us at home need to know about tomorrow's expectation, what nugget could you give us? For those of us that won't be there, what could you give us to go away with?
Watch the God that backs Farrakhan show up great tomorrow, okay. And watch our people unify and defy all the negative stereotypes that we were told we could never do.
Wow.
We'd love to have you come back after the march to kind of do a debrief and hear some good stuff. Thank you, man. Thank you.
Thank you so much. It's been my pleasure.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Minister Victor Muhammad.
Yeah.
Skyping in from Washington, D.C. Justice are off, you guys. 10:10, that's tomorrow. Make sure you tune in. I'm sure it's going to be on broadcast all over the place. And we just want to thank him. He's got his T-shirt right now. He's putting it up on the camera. Look at that.
That's
Justice
it.
Or else. And we're expecting those two X's. Those two X's, my brother. You know, we got to wait on the show.
Two X.
So my girls can be filled up.
There it is.
Thank you so much. We're going to go to our commercial break right now, and we're going to talk about King Drafts. Yes. Do you guys know about King Drafts? King Drafts is fantasy football. It's an amazing fantasy football where it's going strong, but you may not know about it. Now, until 6 weeks ago, a lot of people didn't know about it, but it seems like it's being advertised everywhere. I see it on TV. I'm starting to see more ads. Yeah. I recently was at TwitchCon and they had a booth, and I kind of played a game and got a bag. I'm going to bring my bag of my DraftKings. So if you have a chance, make sure you go to DraftKings. What is our code? We have a code, and I don't see it on our notes. Okay. The code. I am so sorry. They're going to get me on this one. It'll be somewhere around here, but we'll find out what that code is.
We're going to fly down at the bottom. Watch the bottom of the screen.
Steven, do you know what the code is for us? We don't know. But fantasy football. Okay, so if you're a football person, which some women are and some aren't, I want to talk to the girls out there. I know some girls out there that say, you know what, I usually just kind of support my man with the football and I'm on the side. But you know what, girl? Game up on him. Study it. With King Draft. I'm serious. Study King Draft.
And girl, Shirley, it's DraftKings.
DraftKings?
What are you talking about?
Okay, but DraftKings is king of drafts, right?
King of drafts sounds like you're pouring beers really well. Well, you can pour beers really
well. Maybe I had a couple of beers before I had a DraftKings. Okay.
Weekly fantasy football. You ain't beholden to no season. You can win $1 million doing weekly fantasy football with DraftKings. Go to DraftKings.com and use the promo code BLACK.
Oh, the promo code is still black. Okay, so do the promo code black, because I thought it changed. DraftKings. I just want to say one thing out to women out there who don't play football and they want to relate to their man. This is a way you can relate to your man by joining online. I'm serious. Study DraftKings. I said it right. I'm not drinking. Maybe it might be something.
Code black.
Code black. Black people. Power to the people.
Yes.
Thank you so much. The producers always come in and they save us. All right, we're going to move on. You guys know that October the 13th is going to be the first Democrat presidential debate. We will see Hillary Clinton as well as Bernie Sanders. I had been asking, I don't know if there's any other candidates that are going to be there. As you know, the Republican Party, we start off with 16 candidates and has dwindled down. They're somewhere between, I guess, 13 to 14 mm-hmm. or less, give or take.
Some
it changes
on.
Every day.
Yeah, they're hanging
I can't
on
keep
by
up with them all. But they're not hanging on by a thread. They're doing extremely well. They have a very clarity. They are giving the American people options. I have some questions on why the Democrats have only chosen two candidates. You being a Democrat, you represent.
Well, I mean, I think, you know, I think it is unfortunate that we only have two candidates. But I think that it speaks volumes to what the Democratic Party believes about the two candidates that we do have that are at the helm of that. I mean, there are a few others that we talk about who I don't even remember. But we have Bernie Sanders and we have Hillary Clinton. And I think that the legacy that Hillary Clinton has in serving, her history kind of speaks for itself. I think Bernie Sanders has a voting right and kind of a philosophy in his political view that has been in place for years. And I think that together, they probably make a very good team. So I think they could be president and vice president.
Oh, that would be horrible for the country the way I look at it.
Well, I bet it, yeah. Well, so
I have this philosophy I like to share with you. How do you decide on to choosing a minister? How do you choose a minister? So one of the things that I think that we do to choose a president of the United States, what do I do to choose a president of the United States? It's a governor. I'm looking for a governor. I'm looking one that understands businesses and legislation. Mm-hmm. Sometimes when we have people who are elected officials, they're senators and they're congresspeople, they move out of the state and they never build a rapport or relationship with the state. What I want to do is find someone that understands government and legislation. And as much as I am not a Hillary Clinton fan, I do think Hillary has a much better chance than Bernie Sanders.
Well, I think I agree with you, and I'd say that, and I believe that Bernie Sanders has a lot of good to say. Michael, who's at home today, has made me pay attention to Bernie Sanders. I think he has a lot of good to say. I don't agree with everything that he says. But I do think that what you say puts your hand on the pulse of Hillary Clinton, which is that she's been around long enough, and she's pretty much been around this country and this globe enough to be able to get an accurate temperature, an accurate reading. Even today, she met with a team from the Black Lives Matter organization. And I was able to listen to an interview that one of the leaders came out and said that they thought that it was a very forward-moving meeting, that they started off kind of on opposite ends of the spectrum, but then as they talked, because they were able to share ideas and ideals and the differences of those things, and then find the place to create the possibility of understanding each other. And they walked away hearing and understanding
one
another.
Well, she had to school them on like politics 101. You can't come in thinking everything's gonna be rosy-dosy and we're gonna feel good and be nice and kind. You need legislation. So I'm assuming that, and I don't know, I wasn't there, that in this meeting they talked about legislation that will be proposed to help Black lives. You know, as we see things unfold with cases that are being settled, that man who ran away and was gunned down and his family just got a huge settlement today, we're going to find out more and more that more police officers are going to be trained differently. We're going to see more and more police officers wearing cameras.
Right.
We're going to have more and more police officers who are going to think twice on how they approach anyone of color,
right,
and started kind of branding and targeting us.
I think you're correct. And I think when Hillary had an encounter with Black Lives Matter about a month or so ago, they were a little disenchanted with her because what she was saying to them was not so much to affirm what they have been through, because she thought that that was pretty much, and I'm paraphrasing, mm-hmm. she thought that was kind of emotionalizing the situation. But she was directing them to look at legislation. And even here in California.
She was right.
She was absolutely right. She was saying, it's one thing, if you want to change hearts, you'll change a few, but we'll be back here talking about this again in 10 years. But if you change laws, if you implement legislation, then there'll be a difference, you know, that you can see a measurable difference.
Absolutely.
Even here in the state of California, I'm happy.
Right.
Because even my own aunt, Dr. Shirley Nash Weber, you know, in this California State Assembly, authored and fought to see AB 953 bringing ending racial mm-hmm. profiling and bringing accountability to the police officers in the state of California.
Well, if we had more people like Shirley, because Shirley is a great name, if we had more people like Shirley in Congress, elected officials like Shirley caring about the community, we would have a better community. I don't know why they play ring around the rosies with the urban communities. They are elected officials that have been there for many years that know that they could put legislation in place to help warrant better support and security for the community. They should be holding more and more political and as well as police officers accountable for their actions.
Well, I think it's a matter of knowing what do you want. You know, it's one thing.
Absolutely.
It's one thing to march. It's one thing to rally.
Absolutely.
It's one thing to riot. But what is your objective?
Right.
And so the objective of legislation, you'll fight for that.
Even if you know what you want, you need to write that down. You need to do a petition and get it out there. You need to get the support of the people so that it is a bill, so that it could be presented to a committee and then put on a proposed law and make it a proposed law.
But we speak the argument that we're most familiar with. You know, and that for many of us is just the cry. It's just the frustration. It's just the...
Well, we're very emotional people, and I have to admit
that.
We're very passionate people. Emotional may not be the right word. I would say we're very passionate, but that passionate is not getting us the issues we need to be resolved. We need law and legislation in place.
Well, it has its place because although the passion is not getting, it's not getting your objective, it is getting some attention because people are beginning to listen.
We always can get attention. Yeah. Who said we don't get attention? We get attention all the time. I want to see some laws. I want to see something written down. I want to see some amendments. I want to see some proposals. I want to see something, you know, AB2, you know, assembly bill, a Senate bill, some type of bill that will protect the community.
Well, I think that we have to begin to have those type of conversations. How do we organize?
Yes.
You know, Victor, we were talking earlier, and he said they've been studying the whole March on Washington, you know, and it's very good to go back and look at how that whole movement progressed, you know, how we dealt with it.
And I love how you mentioned how a lot of men were motivated by that march, and it changed their life, and it's profound, and it's going to be changing many lives tomorrow.
Right. And what I love about this, is, I mean, being a minister in my own right in the Christian faith, is that there were men there that were not necessarily of the Nation of Islam,
who
felt as if it revived them and it gave them something. So now I think I'm hoping that that's what tomorrow does. I think I was nervous that everything that's been happening in our country over the last couple of years.
The minister says things that are just like profound sometimes. I'm like, oh my God, do you have to say it like that?
Tweetable moment.
You know, I don't know if he does it for publicity or what. He just says things that are just like, oh my God, it's just like piercing, because I have a lot of friends, you know, it sends the fear in people, or is he provoking violence? That's the question, because the things he says sometimes comes off as if he's provoking violence. And so people are anticipating that tomorrow.
They are. I mean, and as we even talk about the political climate of the campaigning and things, it still brings us right back to that place of what do we want? And I think that when we spoke to Victor earlier today, Minister Victor, Student Minister Victor, I guess, for the proper distinction.
That's correct.
Right. But when he talked about he kind of gave the backdrop, the philosophy of it, and I appreciated that.
Yes.
Where there are some very radical things that the Honorable Louis Farrakhan has said, but these things are also consistent throughout the fabric of American history, which then kind of makes you look at it a little different. That's why I think what we do and other people like us, our colleagues above, below, and around us, tend to sensationalize things to put a bent on a story that changes the context of that story so that you never really get what the truth is, but you get what we want you to believe to be the truth. So quite possibly, the Nation of Islam and Farrakhan specifically in his, you know, pontification of such eloquent and profound statements,
absolutely,
and not necessarily trying to fan the flame of anything that's unreasonable.
I won't say that he won't be doing that.
Yeah.
We would hope that he wouldn't. We would hope that he wouldn't.
But you know what?
The minister is embracing the hopes of the community. He feels the community. He knows the community is very angry. Yeah. He knows he's got the eye of Siren looking up on him tomorrow. And he's going to take advantage of that. And he's going to say and do and act and request what he wants. I'm guaranteeing he's going to be requesting. He's going to have a lot of room. He's got the whole enchilada tomorrow.
He does. But you also have to hope that the mass media does not soundbite
mass media is the people now. You have to keep in mind, people are going to be periscoping.
Tweeting, Instagramming, Facebook,
all those things, okay? They'll be YouTubing, they'll be taping. So even though mainstream media of the past could have been able to manipulate or change words, actual people will be able to make their own judgment in that. I do still continue to question legislation. We can rally, feel good, and walk away feeling like we have a brotherhood. That is not going to change anything. No. The only thing that's going to change is law. If you don't correct or change law, then we won't do better in this country.
I agree with you. I couldn't agree with you more on that.
Okay.
How about that? I have some tea on that.
Have some black tea on that one.
Absolutely.
You know, I just want to go back to a little bit about Hillary Clinton, if we can.
Yes.
You know, Hillary Clinton, we talk about a governor. I know she was a governor's wife. Mm-hmm. She still is an ex-governor. He's not an ex-president. He's no longer president. He's no longer governor. But he was a first lady, first wife of a governor. She was the first wife of a president.
Yes.
She was a senator. She also was a Secretary of State for America. Mm-hmm. So she has had her hands in many pots and many stews. Mm-hmm. The challenge I have is the Benghazi.
Mm-hmm, of course.
The email.
Of course.
And the other things that we may not know that will be coming out real soon.
But the American people have entrusted Hillary 4 years.
How have we entrusted Hillary?
Well, you voted her into office.
New York. I'm from L.A.
But we have supported the Clintons. And I think...
I've supported the Clintons.
I admit that I'm, you know, I love me some Hillary. And not because I think that Hillary is one of God's godly green berets. Not that.
Is that time up? Who knows? Boom, boom, boom. What? I'm sorry. She is not God's grace.
No, she's not God's godly green beret. However, I believe that I know her enough.
How do you know her?
But understand this. Knowing her and knowing the temper of that she has as a political figure.
The worst thing. That's the first thing you don't know.
No. I believe I do know that. But I also give room for people to evolve. For example, she has now come out separating herself from Obama on this
She's come out?
No, not come out. She's come out against. She's come out against Obama on the agreement that he just did? I'm having a brain freeze here.
It's okay.
The agreement that he just did. Okay. Anyway, but she had voted, and I think they've counted some 45 times she stood in support of this new agreement. It's going to come to me in a minute.
Well, she's got to distance herself from him because
she's got to distance
his
herself.
Administration has done a lot of things that are not helping the community, and people are very angry knowing that he's leaving.
But,
okay?
But hear this. I particularly get comfortable with people who evolve. It bothers me that you are here in 19. I think she evolves in her opinion, in her belief, in her position. Much like the country. Let's just take the same-sex thing, for example. In 1999, 1988, mm-hmm. I think we had a vote. And everything was trumped upside down. Okay. And then we tried again so many years later. And everything was trumped upside down. And then we tried again. And then all of a sudden, things begin to shift because people begin to look at things.
But that was legislation.
It was not only legislation. It was also no.
It
wasn't
nothing to do with Hillary.
What I'm saying is that not only was it legislation, it was legislation that changed and evolved, but
I
it was
agree.
Also the American people. What it has to do with Hillary is, much like the American people, much like legislation, Hillary can take a particular topic, an issue, and stand for it today, and then look
Donald
at it
Trump
over a course of time, and then say, I don't know. Now that I know more about it, I'm not in support of this. And I don't think there's anything wrong with a political figure, a leader, someone who's vying to be in the White House, to be able to listen and to be able to learn. I get concerned about people who are like,
you know, the problem I have with Hillary Clinton is that I can't trust her. I just can't trust Hillary Clinton because of the emails, because of Benghazi, because of the energy that when she's asked a question, if she wants to avoid or evade any issues that are being addressed to her at that time, she'll step around you. She'll step around you. She is doing that.
Absolutely. Bloomberg. She's a politician.
Well, here we go with Bloomberg, one of the Bloomberg
Who do you think is going to tell you everything?
Let me finish. I didn't cut you off.
Obama didn't tell you everything.
I didn't cut you off. You want to cut me off? You want to
Absolutely.
Do this? You're going to lose. Let me make it clear. Don't vote for Hillary Clinton. Hillary Clinton is not trying to make better for the black community. Because
are you kidding?
Well, yes. No, I don't think so at all.
Oh.
Okay. Why didn't she?
Well, who is? Ben Carson?
Ben Carson?
Yeah.
I'm not talking about Ben Carson. I'm talking about Hillary Clinton.
Who do you think is advocating for the black community?
Who's advocating for anybody but the black community? It should be black people.
That's what we're doing here today. That's why we're in
the
Black Tea Party.
That's why we're
the Black Tea
Party. That's right.
Exactly.
So don't expect Hillary Clinton to help black people, and her husband is not an ex-black president. So just because you had a black man, they call Bill Clinton the black president, don't expect them to say Hillary Clinton is the black mother of black women. I think that's a bunch of bull crap. That's right. It seems like we have come to a close, my black people. Power to the people, the American people out there. Remember to go and watch 1010 Justice or Else. Follow us, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, LinkedIn. Make comments about our show. What did you like about this show? What did you learn today? Did you learn anything? Anything at all?
All right.
I hope that you did. My name is Shirley Husar, H-U-S-A-R. You can follow me on Twitter, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, LinkedIn, and also go to Urban Game Changers and check me out. Thank you so much for watching.
And after you open up all 20 pages on Shirley Husar, just click on over to Don Nash, Don's Daily Dose.
Thank
Talk
you,
to
Victor
me on Twitter,
Muhammad,
Instagram.
So much for being with us as
Victor.
Well. Love you.
And thank you.
Come back
Peace.
To the family.
Yeah.
Peace. Justice or Else tomorrow. From producers Maria Menounos, Dario Kristen, Tiana Hobson, BHL crew, we would like to thank you for supporting Black Hollywood Live, the first online broadcast network dedicated to African American entertainment. For questions and comments, contact us at info@blackhollywoodlive.com. Like us on Facebook, tweet us, or Instagram us at BHL Online. And I'm your BHL announcer, Scipio. Instagram me at Planet Scipio. Thank you for tuning in. You know how they treat. The views expressed here are those of the hosts only and do not necessarily reflect the views of BHL or its owners or principals.